The opera was called The Strange Voyage of Imagining Chatter, and Square and Circle had box seats. They leaned into each other, holding hands as it began. Flickering as from a kinescope, a huge projection of a hand pulls back a tasseled Victorian curtain to reveal a vast collection of odd bones, minerals, shells, fossils, and creatures, dead and alive. Props that artists used for still lifes before they took on a life of their own and metamorphosed into the first museum of natural history. Cabinets of curiosities were stacked floor to ceiling, diminishing with distance like the timeline of a museum. Overture. The orchestra pit was filled with sloppy wet clay and nude musicians. Slowly they began slapping wet globs, pouring water from towering ladders, playing with no conductor, the symphony oddly musicless until their random beats began to coagulate into zygotes of two notes, a harmony of mud and water. Mitosis into four notes, then eight, then 16, then a sour discord, a mutation that caused the entire song to rearrange itself into a new complexity, sound becoming itself, playing itself, the musicians only the medium it lived through. A man with a conch shell for a heart drew out a long, mournful tone. Women jangled mollusks in time with their breasts, the music becoming more differentiated as the orchestra pit continued to dry, a swirling undertone suddenly resolving, as does an ice crystal, before melting back into the bowing of catgut, screeching monkeys, hornpipes and reeds, and a conductor in a starched white collar warily walked out into this growing jungle of sound. At first he flailed his baton to no effect, but then, brandishing his baton as if it were a sorcerer's wand, the noise increasingly seems to obey, the music changing because the orchestra itself keeps changing. Bronze kettle drums, cow moos, an organ with pipes that ranged from needles to smokestacks rises processionally out of the floor, its enormous bellows worked by musicians in black. The organ is joined by a harpsichord with mother-of-pearl inlays. Other instruments incorporated bits of ornamental nature, ivory finger pads, nautilus scrollwork on cellos whose hourglass forms were caressed by musicians in ruffled linen shirts. Moving fast now, their individual migrations come together as glorious waves that fell into a rhythmic pattern, then a clock-like precision in step with directions from the conductor. The busting glass of a car crash punctuates music that rides the crests of an air raid siren on a wah-wah pedal. Tuxedoed musicians began connecting their trumpets to hoses of compressed air, playing notes that were too long and loud to come from human breath. Chords were knocked off balance and put into precarious new arrangements. A row of saxophonists steps to the front, trilling through scales faster than human muscles could trill, the black hoses and wires of their horns giving lips and lungs an assist to reach pitches so high they could only be heard as a faint stinging in the mind, and so low they could only be felt in the bowels before receding back into human hearing and memory. Ethereal music wafts up from women rubbing the wet rims of beakers. Glass bells join glass flutes. The row of mallets within a grand glass piano undulate to poetic sweeps of the conductor's baton, as though he could bring forth the music of this glass orchestra effortlessly, an outpouring of notes paying reverence to his technical mastery. Circle withdrew her hands from Square's and folded them in her lap.